tad closer. Hope I don't intimidate you too much there. I feel like I was so far away. Well, we have gathered here this afternoon to honor the life and or celebrate the life and honor the memory of Margaret Anderson Farrell. Lived a full life at 96 years of age, probably almost 97. She passed away at home, natural causes, and she was residing in Pinson, Alabama, just down the road here. A longtime resident of Huntsville, Alabama, until a year or so ago. And she was a member of Hillwood Baptist Church. She graduated from Lincoln High School in 1944, later received a master's degree from Auburn University. She was a teacher both in Montgomery area and in the Huntsville school systems. Margaret was preceded in death by her husband of 59 years, Robert Farrell, her parents, Edward and Leslie Anderson, and her brothers, Edward Jr., James, and Philip Anderson. Left to cherish her memory, her survivors include her children, Tim Farrell, Mobile, is Suzanne or Susie?
Either one.
Jess and husband Alton McWayne of Mobile, Rosemary and Terrence, is that the Terrence that became a good buddy? Okay, good buddy to Margaret. Bud and Pinson, grandchildren Michael, Jess, Eric, Erica Van Rossum, Jess and Justin Bunn, 7 great-grandchildren, several nieces, nephews, sister-in-laws, Sadie and Neil Anderson. So I guess all of y'all that didn't slaughter your names too badly in the process, and anybody else that didn't get in there. But my name is Bobby Burt, and I'm pastor at University Baptist Church here in Huntsville, and I'm thankful for you as a family asking me and allowing me to be part of this primary moment in your life in the passing of Margaret, and also helping me get to know her. I did not know her. I've never met her. I've never met you before, and you never met me before either. But I'm thankful for you giving me some help in getting to know her. I found that people in life are have a whole lot in common, and not much has changed a whole lot. My mother passed away this past May at 95, so I probably walked down some similar paths as y'all, not exactly, but some similar paths as well. You loved her and you will miss her sorely. I could tell that when I walked in, when the sisters and Tim and y'all were having a moment together. I know you all feel that way. You will miss her. So on behalf of the family, this particular family, I know that you're extended family, but on their behalf, thank you so much for being here today and for supporting one another and being together as you have, and giving them that support in this time of need. Also, I want to say appreciation to Valhalla Funeral Home because they do make a time like this a little bit easier as well. I'm going to have a prayer, and then after the prayer, we'll have our first song, and I believe that's Amazing Grace, and then I'll have the message, and then we'll close with How Great Thou Art. Let's pray together. Loving Father, we thank you for today. We know that today is painful for this family in some ways, and in some ways it is a time of rejoicing to know that Margaret knew her Lord and she is with him in heaven today. So it's kind of a bittersweet type of thing. And we thank you, Father, for the hope that we have in Christ of just having celebrated Easter yesterday, knowing that because of what he did on the cross and it, with his resurrection, it gives us all hope following him, and one day when we die, because of the forgiveness of our sins, being with him and our loved ones in heaven someday. So thank you for that hope. That's very, very real. And we thank you for Margaret's life and the way that each person in this room was allowed to cross her path sometime or other, some longer than others. But because of that crossing and that connection, we feel like we're better people for having known her. And we thank you for the way that she invested in the lives of the people in this room and her family and her friends. So we pray for your help and your grace during this service. May it be one that comforts this family, that brings honor to Margaret, but also brings honor and glory to your name. We thank you in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I will say at the outset today that you do have my deepest sympathy. I do feel with y'all. And it's a painful thing to have to say goodbye to someone that you love. Even if we know that they were Christian, it's temporary. We do have the hope of seeing them again, as you have the hope of seeing Margaret again someday. One of the most encouraging scriptures that I know of to read during a time like this, the death of a loved one, is basically the family has a couple of very dear scriptures to them. One we'll look at now, the other one we'll look at when we go to the interment. And the first one is John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6, and then the 23rd Psalm we will read at the interment. But Jesus said the following in John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. He says, "Let not your heart be troubled." He says, "You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." And Thomas said to Jesus, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way?" And Jesus gives them the way. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus said these words to his disciples at a time that they needed to hear it. They were discouraged. He had just told them that he was going to die. They had followed him for 3.5 years. And they're probably thinking at this time, well, if you're going to die, it's all in vain. We thought we were going to go on and do something else. So he wanted to prepare them for his death. And not only did he prepare them for his death by telling them that I'm preparing a place for you to be with myself and the Father someday in heaven, but he also tells them how to get there. He talks about the way and the how to. And I can't think of a better word for you as a family today, as we honor Margaret's memory and celebrate her life, her passing. A woman who was had a deep faith in God, who was had a dedicated commitment to her church, and also a devoted love for her family. I'm told that Margaret knew her Lord personally and knew that he was preparing her place someday in heaven when she died. So she was ready. You see, for Margaret Farah, Jesus was the way, he was the truth, and he was the life. And as a family, you should have a tremendous amount of hope that you'll see Margaret again, just based on her profession of faith, her testimony to God, and just realizing God's faithfulness to keep his promises to Margaret, as he will to each of us. You see, the Apostle Paul said, when our loved ones die, we shouldn't sorrow like those who have no hope. I like to think of hope as the confident expectation of good from the hand of God. You see, God is a good God. And even though this may look like the end, it's not. You know, when we come to a funeral service, we have all the trappings of the funeral. We have the flowers, we have the casket. And you know, we even have Margaret's body here, but this is not Margaret. You know, it's her body. But Margaret has already gone where she's going. Margaret is very much alive today, and she's in heaven with her Lord. We are here to celebrate her life and to honor her today. Grief is that, I'll talk more about that in a minute. Grief will accompany that. If you love somebody the way you should love them, you're going to feel sad, you're going to feel grief when they pass. That's just the way it is. But I'll guarantee you, as a family, you're not sorrowing as family as I have done funerals for that didn't know Christ and didn't know where their loved ones are. You do, and that gives you hope. You see, this hope that Margaret had provided her with 96, almost 97 years, full years. She got to do so many things. And I was so pleased that the family helped me get to know her a little bit, the things that so many of us miss out on that she didn't. I mean, she went to school. She had parents, good parents. She graduated from Auburn. She used her degree to help special needs children and to reach and bless children all throughout their ages. She loved flowers. Once again, spoke of her nurturing, the nurturing aspect of who Margaret was. She loved flowers, gardening. She loved to cook. And I also heard she was a really good cook. And she loved to see you clean your pretty plates. You ever heard her say that? But, you know, she was one of those individuals, kind of like my mom. They don't make them like that anymore. I'm sorry. They just don't. She was of a special mold. She was a very simple, plain woman, but she loved to help others. And you know, the scripture says that there's an inner beauty that a person can have that far outshines the outside beauty. And she had plenty of inner beauty as well. She never withheld help from those who needed it. She was a wife who loved her husband and took care of him even when he couldn't take care of himself. And children, she loved you. She loved you. Susie, Rosemary, Tim, she loved you guys. And she loved all of you. Her grands, her great-grands, and everyone else here. And those are just some of the reasons you're going to miss her. And these are also some of the reasons that will give you good memories of her, and even more reason that you have to look forward to seeing her again someday. So what I'd like to do in just the remainder of what I have to say, I'd like to share four words with you that I want you to think about when you remember Margaret. Okay? Four words. Real easy. The first one is rest. Rest. I'm going to say that this woman had an incredible work ethic. Probably well up into her 70s and 80s, she could probably outwork two or three 30-year-olds, if I'm right. Okay? So she had an incredible work ethic. She worked all of her life, and as you can see, and I can see on her face and some of the most recent pictures that you have of her at 96, she was tired. She was just tired. You know, these bodies weren't meant to last forever. Not these. And you know, they say it's the mileage that gets you, right? It's the mileage that gets you. And she had a lot of miles on that body. And you know, eventually they just kind of wear out. And it's time for us to get the rest. So God's given her a rest. As Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 9 tells us, there remains therefore a rest unto the people of God. So I don't know what she's doing in heaven, but you know, whatever it is, it won't seem like the kind of work that she's done for the past 96. That's the first word, rest. Second word is reunion. In Genesis 25, verse 8, it says this: Then Abraham breathed his last breath and died at a good old age and was gathered to his people. Now, I say reunion because that verse doesn't mean that he was taken to the family cemetery and just buried. Okay? I know we do that, but that's not what it's saying here. It's saying that Abraham had a lot of family and people that he loved that had gone on to be with the Lord before he died. And when he breathed his last breath, it means that because of his faith in God, he was gathered to those people to see them again. Now, I don't know y'all's family tree. I don't know, but she had family, you know, galore that goes back generations. Friends and loved ones. And that's one of the things that happened with Margaret. She got to be gathered to her people again. She got to see her people. You know, there's a lot to that old song. I used to make fun of it when I was a kid. And Mom and Daddy drug me to every gospel singing that could ever be had back in the day. But anyway, I kept on hearing this song, "I've got more to go to heaven for than I did yesterday." And I made fun of that until I got to be 63. And now I'm beginning to realize the reality of it. You know, as my friends die off, and as my family die off, I'm getting to the point that I've got about as many of them up there as I do down here. And my mother was 95, and God bless her, she only had one good friend left. I thought there won't be anybody at Mama's funeral, because they're all gone. She had a good number, but none of them were old friends. They were all up there. So can you imagine the look on her face when she got to see all the family and the friends that she had that went on to be with the Lord in heaven? See, that's what I'm talking about with reunion. And it'll be even more happy when y'all all get there. And you will one of these days. I know you won't think about it, but all of us will. And we'll get to see her again someday. So rest, reunion. Third word, reward. Reward. God not only promises to take us to heaven when we die, if we're a Christ follower, but he promises a reward. Now, I don't think a lot about that. I don't know what all that's going to look like. I know there's all kind of rewards in the scripture, but I just want to read just a quick passage for you. It's found in Matthew chapter 25, beginning with verse 34, and he gives us a little clue as to about what may happen someday. Jesus said, "And then the king will say to those on his right hand, 'Come and be blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me.' Then the righteous will answer and say, 'Lord, when did we ever see you hungry, and we fed you? When were you thirsty and we gave you ever see you a stranger and we took you in, or naked and clothed you? Or when did we ever see you sick and come to visit you? We didn't do any of that to you. And the king will answer and say to them, surely I say unto you, as much as you did it unto the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. And I believe there's a special reward in heaven for people like that. And one of the things that you can't skip over in Margaret's life is that y'all told me that whenever there was someone who needed help, she never passed over. She always had time to stop for children, for people who were in need, for people who were less fortunate than her. I'll say no more except whatever reward she gets, I don't know, but I do know this, by far the best one that I'm sure she heard the moment she got to heaven was when her Lord said, well done, my good and faithful servant. That's the best. That's what we all want to hear, isn't it? Okay, rest, reunion, reward. Last one, remembrance. You will never forget this lady. And you shouldn't. Her memory will always grow fresh in your hearts. And I want to encourage you as a family, extended family, think of all the good times that you've had together and all the good things you've done together. I know there's bad things that happen in families. No family is perfect. But don't dwell on those things. Dwell on the good times. Dwell on the good things. That's what will get you through. Support one another as a family. That will help you get through the difficult days ahead. You see, and now I'm going to say what I'm going to say about grief. Grief is very real. Grief is an emotion that we feel, that God wired us to feel, because we love someone the way we should have. It's the void you feel, it's the miss you feel, it's the sickness you feel in your heart because Margaret's not here with us today. One of the best definitions of grief that I ever heard in my life, someone told me not long ago who lost a loved one very close to them. They said, so grief is love with no place to go. Think about it. You all still love Margaret, but she can't love you back right now. You can close your eyes and imagine what it feels like to hug her and for her to hug you back, but you see, she can't do that right now because she's not with us right now, because she's in heaven right now. So let me just reiterate, based on her profession of faith, in God and God's faithfulness to keep his promises, one day you will see her again. And when you do, I hope that you'll be able to say, Margaret, thanks for the memories. They kept us going. And you know what? We've carried on as much as we could the way you wanted us to carry on. We did our best to be good stewards of your legacy. So you see, comfort yourselves in this. You are the keepers of her memory. You are the stewards of her legacy. So talk about her a lot. Tell her stories. I'm sure there are tons of stories that you all know about this lady. Cook her recipes, for goodness sakes, and enjoy her food. It'll remind you of her in a good way. Pick her roses. Make bouquets. Work in the yard. Do the stuff that she did. It'll bring up some good memories that you have of her for a long, long time. And meanwhile, comfort yourself with knowing that what Margaret has done in dying, she has simply gone out to be with the Lord, where disease and sickness and sorrow, that stuff that plague us, will never touch her again. And someday, we will see her again and be at home with her and the rest of the family and friends with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There's a wonderful poem. Actually, I don't know if it's so much a poem as it is prose, but I'd like to close with it. It was penned by Henry Jackson Van Dyke back in the probably that late 1800s, and it's entitled The Ship, and it's his attempt to describe death, and I like it, and I hope you will too. He asked the question, what is dying? I'm standing on the seashore, and a ship sails in the morning breeze and starts for the ocean. She is an object of beauty, and I stand watching her till at last she fades on the horizon somewhere, just where the horizon and the clouds kind of mingle together. And someone at my side says, "Look, she's gone." Gone where? Well, she's gone from my sight. That's really all. Because you see, that ship that sailed from my side, she's just as large in mast and hull and spar as she was when I saw her leave, and just as able to bear her a load of living freight to its destination. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at that moment when someone at my side says, "There, she's gone," there are others watching her coming toward them with voices and a glad shout saying, "There she comes." And that is dying. And I like that. Family, God bless you. Thank you for allowing me to be part of this primary moment in your life. It's an honor. And you do have my prayers, and you have my deepest Christian sympathy. Let's pray together. Loving Father, we do thank you for your word. It's so comforting to know that this is not the end, but it's the beginning of another journey. It's not the final chapter of the book, but a whole new beginning of another book. And Father, we thank you that Margaret is well on her way, and she's with you in heaven and doing whatever y'all do there. Father, thank you that we have the opportunity, because of Christ and what he's done for us, to see her again someday, to go to heaven when we die, to have a glad reunion with those that we love. So Father, continue to comfort this family. May they be blessed. May they share memories and stories and be together as a family and support one another and look forward to the day when either we get there or you return. We pray this.